touch the spindle. Touch it, I say.
Ow! Now I need a band-aid.
Happy place. Welcome.
Here age relives fond memories of the past. And here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future.
To voice your comments, ask a question, or make a request, send an email to mouselounge@gmail.com. Visit the mouselounge.com website anytime, or friend us on Facebook at facebook.com/mouselounge. To support the Mouse Lounge podcast, visit the website and look for the PayPal link along the left side. Lastly, if you like the show, be sure to post a review for the Mouse Lounge podcast on iTunes. Each week, in From the Vault, we sample a clip from a classic Disney film, short, television or radio program, or Disneyland record. This week, we present a Disneyland little long-playing record. First, listen to a short biography about the incomparable Disneyland story reader, Robie Lester, followed by her exquisite telling of the story of Sleeping Beauty. Next, a special Mouse Lounge mini-documentary about the history of the 1959 Disney feature film, Sleeping Beauty. From the Walt Disney Archives, explore the history of the original Sleeping Beauty castle walkthrough attraction in Disneyland. Each week we present a high-definition ride-through from a Disney Park East or a Disney Park West. This week we feature a slight departure from our typical ride-through. So often we walk through Sleeping Beauty Castle in Disneyland on our way to our favorite Fantasyland attraction. This time, we stop just beyond the castle and listen to hear a beautiful medley of music from the films that define the Fantasyland sound experience. We'll close this week's show with a trio of unique interpretations of Sammy Fain's Once Upon a Dream. First, from the 6-disc superset, A Musical History of Disneyland, we board King Arthur's Carousel and hear a fantastic arrangement for Stinson Band Organ. Then we'll delve in a bit of Disney bubblegum pop and hear Emily Osment's auto-tuned performance. And just about when 3 minutes of Disney mania convinces you there's no such thing as talent, have a listen to the original Aurora and Prince Philip, Mary Costa, and Bill Shirley from the remastered soundtrack. And now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please keep your head, arms, feet, and legs inside the podcast at all times.
I'm a York player.
Disney News Entertainment from Forbes.com. Disney has announced that it's buying distribution rights to The Avengers and Iron Man 3 from Paramount for $115 million. Paramount will reportedly still earn the 8-9% fees it would have received from distributing the films, but it won't have to put in any advertising money or muscle. The deal's an expensive one for Disney, but it does make good sense. The Mouse House spent $4 billion to buy Marvel Entertainment last year. The comic book company owns the rights to such high-profile superheroes as Spider-Man, Iron Man, and the X-Men. But most of those film franchises are already at other studios. Sony releases the Spider-Man films, Fox has the X-Men. When Disney first made the purchase, it looked like it would either have to exploit less well-known heroes or wait for the franchise rights to expire at other studios. By making the deal to buy distribution rights to The Avengers and Iron Man 3, the studio brings in-house two of the most important upcoming Marvel films. The Avengers, which is slated to be directed by Joss Whedon, will feature a slew of Marvel characters, including Iron Man, Thor, and the Incredible Hulk. Disney can now produce its marketing for any future projects involving Iron Man and more easily incorporate the characters into Disney merchandise and spin-off products. The move also makes sense for Paramount. A full 92% of Iron Man's $622 million global box office take went to Marvel and Disney anyway. This frees up Paramount executives to work on in-house franchises like Star Trek and Mission Impossible 4 with Tom Cruise and Jeremy Renner, which is already filming. Paramount will still release the Marvel movies Thor and Captain America. From the New York Times, Walt Disney Studios confirmed a report on the blog CartoonBrew.com that Brenda Chapman, heralded as the first woman to direct a Pixar film, the forthcoming Brave, has been replaced at the helm of that picture by Mark Andrews, the director of the 2005 Pixar short One Man Band. Pixar has faced criticism from some corners about its lack of gender diversity behind the camera. All 11 of the celebrated animation studio's features have been directed by men. Some movie critics, bloggers, and others have also faulted Pixar for a shortage of leading ladies on screen, with most of its films, Up, Toy Story, Cars, Monsters, Inc., all focused on male characters. Brave, scheduled for release in June 2012, was supposed to squelch such complaints. Ms. Chapman, who directed The Prince of Egypt for DreamWorks Animation in 1998, has been working for years on Brave, which, in an extra display of girl power, is centered on a woman. The movie tells the tale of a Scottish princess, Merida, who defies her parents by pursuing archery. Contrary to blog reports, Ms. Chapman remains on staff at Pixar. It's not unusual for animated films, particularly those made by Pixar, to change directors midway through a project. From Rolling Stone, Lady Gaga and Elton John, who teams up to open the 52nd annual Grammys back in January, have collaborated on a new song, Hello Hello. It will appear on the soundtrack for the Disney animated film, Romeo and Juliet. The film hits theaters February 11, 2011. John, who is a producer on Romeo and Juliet, co-wrote the movie's soundtrack with composer James Newton Howard. He's contributed music to movies before, most notably with his Oscar-winning The Lion King soundtrack. Hello Hello marks Gaga's first contribution to a feature film. From the Orlando Sentinel, users of Android-powered smartphones, like me, can now enjoy the Walt Disney World Notescast app. TimeStream Software released the Android version of the theme park guide on Friday. It features more than 300 pages of information about the four Walt Disney World parks, as well as hundreds of photos. Users can find information about dining, parades, photo opportunities, and tours. There's also information about how to plan your Walt Disney World vacation, where to find the characters in the park, and features for guests with disabilities. Though it isn't entirely exhaustive in Walt Disney World topics, what guide is, it features plenty of other information, and the app is very easy to use. It costs $3.99 and can be downloaded from notescast.com or the Android Market Travel category. Apple iPod and iPhone users can get the app through the iTunes Store. Disney News, Theme Parks West. From the Orange County Register, hotel union members are handing out flyers warning visitors of the potential of pedophiles at Disneyland, a missive that a police official says misrepresents facts. The flyers cite Anaheim police calls and sex offender statistics under the headline of "Keep Your Children Close, Places Like Disneyland Are Magnets for Pedophiles." The union, Unite Here Local 11, has been embroiled in a contract dispute with Disney for almost 3 years. Disneyland Resort spokeswoman Susie Brown said, quote, "Local 11's leadership has reached a new low with this reprehensible tactic, and they should be ashamed of themselves," end quote. Lee Shelton, a Unite Here spokeswoman, denies that the flyers are related to the contract dispute. The flyers state, "A service from Unite Here," and include tips for keeping children safe. Shelton says, "We think this is an important issue. This is a serious problem that affects anybody whose children go to Disneyland, and that includes our members." Sergeant Rick Martinez, spokesman for the Anaheim Police Department, said he knows of no major pedophile problems at Disneyland. Union representatives requested police reports from the addresses of the Disneyland Resort's 2 theme parks, 3 hotels, downtown Disney, and parking lots. The flyer states, the Anaheim police were called to Disneyland 64 times from 2005 to 2010 to investigate sex offenses, 9 of them in the first half of 2010. Martinez said he knows of no pedophile-related reports, although he has yet to review them all. Shelton said that police refused to release 43 of the reports, citing a state law that requires confidentiality related to child abuse and neglect cases. That led union officials to believe that they were child-related crimes. Of the remaining 21 reports, 2 included registered sex offenders who were arrested. Shelton says, "It's not a stretch. This is just the facts. The leaflet just puts forth the facts and offers some solutions." The story goes on to list specific sex-related acts named in the reports, all of which would be a perfectly normal occurrence during grad night. From the OC Register, the tall structure that was the Malibumer is gone from the skyline of DCA forever. The attraction was removed as part of the Disneyland Resort's makeover of the theme park. The area is currently planned to have a park-like setting when all the work is complete. A construction crane was on site but could only be used in the early morning hours to dismantle the attraction, as it operated above and over the California Screamin' roller coaster. The ride was similar to Knott's Berry Farm's Supreme Scream, with some differences, including a rapid rise to the top. Several members of Disney fam websites longed for the attraction to be torn down. However, there are a few fans of the ride, and they ran a Facebook page in support of it. The crane and the ride are now gone. Also from the OC Register, the high-tech talking Mickey Mouse that's been a fixture on the Cinderella Castle forecourt stage in the show Dream Along with Mickey will begin making regular appearances at DCA as part of a new show. This is the first time that the upgraded Mickey character, which has a moving mouth and blinking eyes, will routinely appear in front of visitors at Disneyland Resort. Mickey will play a central role in Disney Dance Crew that debuted last week in DCA. Until now, the talking Mickey has only showed up on a limited basis at the resort. In May, Disneyland tested out the talking Mickey, who greeted guests by name and had conversations during meet-and-greet sessions. DCA also used the talking Mickey during the private premiere ceremony of World of Color in June. While the new Mickey is not expected to greet guests at DCA, the character is slated to dance and talk during the show. Disney officials declined to discuss the details of the talking Mickey in the new dance show, reluctant to give away any of the magic. Taking a cue from John Lasseter's PR script, show director Randy Wojcik said, "We are introducing and featuring Mickey in a brand new way. We're really excited to bring Mickey's new performance style to guests." The Disney show is choreographed by Tassandra Chavez of So You Think You Can Dance and Dave Scott, who also works on the show and the Step Up movies. The music will be a fresh arrangement and mashup of Disney tunes, he said. The Disney show will feature 2 dance crews who are competing against each other when they're interrupted by Mickey Mouse, who reveals his own hip moves and brings the two sides together. Disney Dance Crew is set for 6 performances a day, 5 days a week on the Hollywood Pictures backlot stage. The dance show will replace Drawn to the Magic, which ended last weekend. Authorities identified Thursday a 61-year-old man who fell to his death from the top floor of the parking structure at Disneyland. Ghassan Trabulsi of Monrovia was found about 8:45 p.m. last Sunday near the southwest corner of the Mickey and Friends parking structure on Walnut Street and Magic Way, said Anaheim Police Sergeant Rick Martinez, who's clearly working overtime at Disneyland these days. Trabulsi was taken to a hospital where he died at 1:30 a.m. An autopsy performed Tuesday revealed Trabulsi died of multiple traumatic injuries, consistent with a fall, said Orange County Supervising Deputy Coroner Daniel Aiken. Trabulsi had a suicide note, said Martinez, adding that he may have been undergoing personal issues. Surveillance cameras around the 6-story parking structure did not capture the fall, but evidence found indicated he jumped from the top floor. A Disneyland staple will shut down temporarily to get a makeover for the park's holiday season. It's a Small World will begin the transformation, which includes thousands of lights, new costumes, and festive songs, on Monday, October 25th. The Fantasyland attraction will reopen as It's a Small World Holiday when the Disneyland Resort season starts November 12th. The theme park's holiday runs through January 2nd. Disneyland has revamped the classic ride every year since 1997. Disney Business, from the Orlando Sentinel. Disney's theme park unit has struck a multi-year sponsorship deal with Ocean Spray, the Massachusetts-based cranberry growing cooperative. Under the deal, Disney will begin peddling dried cranberries at Walt Disney World and Disneyland and aboard the Disney Cruise Line ships. It will highlight the product with new signature salads and cranberry muffins. And it will design Chip and Dale-themed packaging for Ocean Spray products sold on Disney properties. Ocean Spray will even build cranberry bog displays for Disney's popular in-park food and wine festivals, both the California version to be held April 29th through June 12th next year, and Epcot's International Edition next fall. Ocean Spray calls it the largest promotional pact of its kind in the co-op's 80-year history. From Reuters, three of the biggest U.S. television broadcasters have blocked their shows from Google Inc.'s new web TV service, throwing a wrench into the company's plans to expand from computers to the living room. Spokespeople from Disney and NBC Universal confirmed that the company's blocked access to its broadcast TV shows from Google TV. Disney owns network and cable TV businesses ABC and ESPN. Fox is also considering blocking access to its shows on the website, but a decision has not yet been made. CBS has blocked access to full-length episodes of their programs, including popular fare like CSI Crime Scene Investigation. Google TV, which became available this month in the United States, allows consumers to access web content on their TV screens. The service, which is built into devices from Sony and Logitech International, could open new advertising opportunities for Google, which generates the bulk of its roughly $24 billion in annual revenue from web search ads. News from the ships, from the Orlando Sentinel. The first of the two new cruise ships Disney is having built in Germany will float out of its covered construction dock for the first time next weekend, according to the shipyard building the vessel. Meyer Werft says the 4,000-passenger Disney Dream will float away from its sheltered dock on Saturday, October 30th. The ship won't go far. Upon leaving the dock, Meyer Werft says the Dream will remain in the shipyard harbor to undergo a series of trials, testing technical systems such as its stabilizers and rudders. It will remain berthed along the yard pier for yet another 2 weeks as interior construction continues. Meyer Werft said it expects the Dream to depart the shipyard on the second weekend in November when it will be conveyed down the River Ems and into the North Sea. It's scheduled to arrive in Port Canaveral in January. It's impossible to calculate how many lives Robie Lester touched by singing, acting, and narrating on more individual Disneyland records than any other performer. Lester was born in the microscopic town of McGargle, Texas, but moved at an early age to northern Ontario, Canada. At age 14, Lester left home and made a new life for herself in Detroit. She loved the escapism of the great movie musicals of the 1940s, and she and a friend would, quote, go to see every musical that came to the theater, and then we would walk down the sidewalk singing all the songs from the movie at the top of our voices. People thought we were strange. Lester spent a year and a half in the U.S. Air Corps before attending UCLA and majoring in music. Blessed with a clear, powerful voice, Lester was equally adept at singing for dramatic or comedic purposes. Her comic timing came in handy for Henry Mancini's novelty LP, Terribly Sophisticated Songs. Girl singers were far from rare in Hollywood, so Lester broadened her horizons by developing an uncanny knack for vocal impersonations. Her ability to sing as well as speak in character was put to frequent use in radio commercials and animated cartoons. From Hills Brothers coffee ads, accompanied by the Mellow Men, to episodes of The Famous Adventures of Mr. Magoo. Before her Disney days, Lester appeared on several pop singles for the Liberty label. Lester also worked as a demo singer, performing compositions to assist aspiring songwriters. In this capacity, the Sherman Brothers brought her singing and acting talents to the attention of Disney's record division. Lester was initially cast as the sped-up voice of Dale of the Chipmunk team, Chip and Dale, but by the early 1960s, she was narrating Disneyland LPs of various types and doing numerous roles within the stories. She also sang the theme song over the opening credits of Disney's The Three Lives of Thomasina. When Disneyland Records launched its first See, Hear, Read 7-inch 33 1/3 RPM book and record sets in 1965, Lester was the original Disneyland Story Reader, which added considerably to her quantity of Disneyland Record performances. "Robie could handle anything I would give her to do," said Tootie Camerata. "She was often handed scripts and asked to wing it with virtually no preparation, but she would make the performance work." In December 1970, audiences enjoying the new Disney animated feature, The Aristocats, were hearing Robie Lester singing for Ava Gabor's character, Duchess. When they listened to the storyteller LP, they heard Lester speaking and singing the role. "She's a wonderful gal," said Richard Sherman. "She did a beautiful recording of She Never Felt Alone. In the picture, Ava just talked a few lines, but this was the whole song. It was great to hear that song done the way my brother and I had written it. She did a great job." It's one of the few Lester performances that's been reissued on CD. That same December, the Rankin-Bass stop-motion animated Christmas special, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, premiered on ABC. Lester played opposite Mickey Rooney's Kris Kringle as Miss Jessica, the schoolteacher who eventually becomes Mrs. Santa Claus. Her earnest performance, including the show-stopping My World is Beginning Today, demonstrating why she was one of the best soloists in Hollywood. Lester's final Disneyland LP performance was in The Orange Bird in 1971. She continued to work in radio advertising and animation, but recuperation from two 1972 open heart surgeries put her out of commission, and by the time, quote, "I was ready to go back to work, all of my former producers and directors had changed jobs or died, and no one knew who I was," end quote. Disney's animators had not forgotten, though, and when Gabor was cast in The Rescuers in 1977, Lester was again called in to sing Rescue Aid Society for Miss Bianca. In the years that followed, Lester wrote the novel Heaven's Gift and busied herself with her family and several charitable causes, primarily animal welfare and the Random Acts of Kindness program. She continued to write and perform and was on hand to cheer her friend Tootie Camerata when he was honored at the Walt Disney Studios in 2003. Her final appearance was in an episode of the acclaimed children's radio drama Adventures in Odyssey. She lived quietly in California's citrus country with her husband Jeff and her many animal friends until her death on June 14, 2005. Lester took great pleasure in knowing that she had a legion of fans who grew up, just like me, enjoying her work. And now sit back and relax and listen to the incomparable Robie Lester reading Sleeping Beauty.
This is a Disneyland original little long-playing record, and I am your story reader. I am going to begin now to read the story of Sleeping Beauty. You can read along with me in your book. You will know it is time to turn the page when Tinker Bell rings her little bells like this. Let's begin now. Once upon a time, in a kingdom far away, a baby princess was born. She was so lovely that her parents named her Aurora, which means dawn. The day of the princess's christening was set apart as a holiday. Everyone was invited to the party, including the three good fairies, Flora, Fauna, and Merryweather. Although Maleficent, the fairy of darkness, was not invited to the christening, she appeared anyway. She was in a rage at not being invited and cried,
"I have a gift for the princess, and this is it. Before the sun sets on her 16th birthday, the princess will prick her finger on a spindle and die."
Oh, no, the cry rose from every heart. But in an instant, Maleficent had vanished in a flash of flame. Then Merryweather stepped forward to give the last gift. "Perhaps I can soften this blow," she said. "This is my gift. Should the princess prick her finger on a spindle, she will not die. She will fall into a deep sleep until she is awakened by her true love's kiss."
"This does not take away the evil threat," groaned the king. "We must take action. Let every spindle and spinning wheel in the country be burned."
But the good fairies knew that would not stop Maleficent. They thought of a better plan. Let us raise the princess in a secret hiding place, they begged. We will keep her safe until her 16th birthday. And that was how it happened that the Princess Aurora grew up in a tiny cottage in the woods. She had a host of animal friends and three sweet godmothers who called her Briar Rose. One day, as her 16th birthday drew near, Briar Rose chanced to meet a handsome young man in the woods, and at once they fell in love. Briar Rose never dreamed that he was Prince Philip, whom her parents planned that she should wed. He, in turn, never dreamed that she was a princess, but she asked him to come that evening to the cottage to meet her godmothers. Home to the cottage went Briar Rose, dancing with joy. There, a surprise was waiting for her. The fairy godmothers had baked a beautiful cake in honor of her 16th birthday. But when Prince Philip told his father of the lovely girl he had met, the good king roared,
"Oh, no, you have been promised for 16 years to the Princess Aurora of the next kingdom."
"I cannot," said Philip. "My heart and hand are promised to the loveliest girl in the world." And so Philip gave up his right to the throne, and he rode away to the cottage in the woods to meet his own true love. Briar Rose was not there. The good fairies had taken her to the castle. But they left her alone for a moment, and what a sad mistake that was. For outside the palace, the sun was sinking. Maleficent knew that her evil spell was ending. No sooner had the three good fairies tiptoed away than the room was filled with magic calling, "Aurora, Aurora." Bewitched by the music, the Princess Aurora followed its call to a tiny tower room. There in the shadows, the evil fairy Maleficent watched as the princess slowly approached a golden spinning wheel. She reached out her hand to touch the shining surface and pricked her finger, and she fell at once into a magical sleep. That was where the good fairies found her. "The kiss of true love! We must find him!" they cried. Just then, Flora heard the voice of King Hubert of the next kingdom speaking sadly,
"That boy of mine, Philip, has lost his head. Fell in love, he says, with some little girl he met in the woods."
Prince Philip was Aurora's true love. With a wave of their wands, the fairies put the whole palace into a magical sleep. Then they hurried to try and find Prince Philip. But Maleficent had captured him and taken him to her castle. So the good fairies went to the rescue. Slipping past Maleficent's guards, they found Prince Philip in the dungeon. They armed him with the sword of truth, the shield of virtue, and the strength of true love. Then they led him out of the castle and back to the sleeping princess. Maleficent's rage was furious when she found that the prince had escaped. She turned herself into a fiery dragon. But her evil could not overcome the power of truth, virtue, and true love. Soon the fairies were showing Prince Philip the tiny tower room where his princess lay asleep. At her prince's kiss, Aurora opened her eyes. Then around her, the whole sleeping castle awoke. The joyous celebration started up again. Now it was even more joyous than before, for there was news of the wedding soon to come, and happiness ever after was ahead for the sleeping beauty and her own true love.
Walt Disney's Sleeping Beauty is based on the fairy tale La Belle au Bois Dormant by Charles Perrault. Another fairy tale Disney picture wouldn't be made until The Little Mermaid, 30 years later. Like with so many fairy tales, Sleeping Beauty had a major issue right from the start that made it difficult to make into a full-length animated feature. Aladdin animator Will Finn and professor of animation at USC, Christine Panushka.
Sleeping Beauty is one of those problematic stories. Like a lot of fairy tales, it's about 4 or 5 paragraphs long, you know, if that.
So there's not a lot of action, and they had to go back and put some conflict and some tension into this, and so they changed the story. There's not 100 years between when Aurora goes to sleep and Prince Philip comes to find her, and he does have conflict. He has to battle Maleficent as the dragon, a spectacular scene.
Unlike his other fairy tales, Walt dispensed with using business and subplots like the mice in Cinderella to round out the running time, instead focusing on the reality of the story and subtlety of the main characters. Several story points for Sleeping Beauty came from discarded ideas for Disney's previous fairy tale involving a sleeping heroine, Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. They include Maleficent's capture of the prince as well as the prince's daring escape from her castle. Disney discarded these ideas from Snow White as his artists were not able at the time to draw the human male anatomy believably enough. Also dispatched from Snow White, but used in Sleeping Beauty, were the dance with the woodland creatures in the prince's clothing and the fantasy sequence of the prince and princess dancing in the clouds, which was considered for Cinderella, but ultimately dropped. Sleeping Beauty spent nearly the entire decade of the 1950s in production. Walt, typically inextricable in his capacity as head storyman, was distracted, however, by his live-action films and designing Disneyland. Just the same, the story work began in 1951 and was fairly well set by 1952, though perhaps lacking some of the warmth and heart that Walt would typically inject into his pictures. If the story wasn't particularly compelling, the same could not be said for the sumptuous look of the film. A bold new form of animation. Art, which Walt wanted to look like a living illustration, inspired by medieval art, and not typical of the Disney style. Again, animator Will Finn.
You know, a lot had happened since Snow White, and in the post-war era, illustration and design went through a major sea change. And Sleeping Beauty seems to have been an attempt to answer that in a feature film with something that was more designy, more sophisticated, more decorative than any other Disney movie it had ever been before.
The film does away with the soft, rounded characters of earlier Disney features in lieu of a more stylized, angular look. Since Super Technorama 70 was used, it also meant the backgrounds could contain far more detail and complex artwork than ever used in an animated feature before. Disney layout artist John Hench visited the cloisters of the Metropolitan Museum of Art Medieval Galleries in Manhattan. With sketches based on the unicorn tapestries he saw, Hench approached Walt, who decided that this was the look he wanted for the film. But the picture really belongs to Disney artist Ivan Earle, who made trial paintings based on John Hench's sketches and was assigned as the film's color stylist and chief background designer. To avoid watering down the intended international gothic look of the film, Walt gave Earle significant freedom designing the settings and selecting colors for the picture, and ultimately he painted nearly all the backgrounds himself. The elaborate paintings took Earle 7 to 10 days to finish, when a typical animation background took only one workday to complete. Ivan Earle.
I first started with the old medieval artists and almost everything that was Gothic. The tapestries were perfect examples of how foregrounds ought to be. The Gothic came from the Persians. And all their little details of grasses and weeds and trees fit perfectly. And over all of that, a little tiny bit of myself came through.
The styling, however, became an issue as it sometimes overtook the animation. The animators had two major challenges. The backgrounds were so detailed and busy that it was difficult to make the characters stand out against them. Also, the characters needed to be stylized in such a way that they matched the backgrounds. Walt suggested that all three good fairies should look alike, but veteran animators Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston objected, saying that three identical fairies wouldn't be exciting enough. They fought to have the fairies with unique personalities, looks, and colors. Disney animation historian Brian Sibley.
The animators got their way too, because what they managed to do was to bring into those characters something which was the familiar Disney feeling. Although the characters wore geometric capes and pointed hats, they're warm, they're round, they're cuddly. These are Disney characters.
Disney animator Ollie Johnston.
So we started figuring how we could develop them into special personalities. Like Fauna came from a person that Frank met in Colorado.
She's an officer in a ladies' club, and so they called on her for her inspirational piece for the day, and she said, "Oh dear, I don't seem to be able to find this, but I have a letter here from my cousin Susie who says some very interesting things I think you'll be interested in." So she read the letter from her cousin Susie.
Of course.
And she was so sweet and so affectionate, but she wasn't with it. And I said, there's our character.
Oh.
Everybody was working to try to lighten up the picture because it needed something to give it some more life.
The name of the Sleeping Beauty in the film, as it was in the original Tchaikovsky ballet, is Aurora, Latin for dawn. While in hiding, she's referred to as Briar Rose, the name of the princess in the Brothers Grimm variation of the story. Maleficent was aptly named as it literally means evildoer. Both animated by the brilliant Mark Davis, one of Walt's famed nine old men. In determining Maleficent's design, standard depictions of witches and hags were dismissed as it would too closely resemble the Wicked Queen's guise in Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, and animator Davis opted for a more elegant look. In his research of period medieval artwork, Davis came across a religious illustration of a woman dressed elegantly devilish with flowing capes resembling flames. With this image, he based the look of the character on the appearance of flame, ultimately crowning the villain with horns of the devil. He even went so far as to give Maleficent bat-like wings for a collar. Mark Davis.
It's very difficult to do a character that speaks more or less directly to the audience and does not work closely with another character. So the one thing she had to work with was the raven.
Milt Kahl was given the unenviable task of animating Prince Philip, so named as it was a royal familiar to most Americans of the 1950s, Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. Mark and Milt both would have preferred to animate more dynamic, interesting characters in the picture, but as Alice Davis, wife of Mark Davis, put it, they always got stuck with the most realistic animation because they were the best draftsmen. Wooly Reitherman, who would later direct Jungle Book, was assigned the climactic battle sequence between the dragon and the prince, a spectacular sequence even though logic took a back seat to the emotion of the scene. Animation director, Wooly Reitherman.
You didn't know how he got through the thorns or how his horse ever got up there. They used to criticize that thing when I showed it first, but Walt liked it, thank goodness. It didn't need the logic. You didn't have time to think. That thing was driving at you all the time. And that's what gives you the juices. That's what makes your adrenaline go.
About casting the picture, Walt Disney biographer Bob Thomas said, "That is one thing you can see Walt's hand in, and that is in the casting. He was very meticulous about who he wanted to speak the lines." Animation historian Charles Solomon and Pixar director Peter Docter.
What you look for in a voice for animation is someone who will give the animators some hints as to what the character is doing.
That's the artistry of voice actor, is to make it sound as though these characters are breathing and alive.
Mary Costa was cast as Princess Aurora. Mary Costa.
Walt Disney called me and he said,
You have a warm, warm voice. And it expresses love from your heart. Also, your voice is so naturally placed that you can use your singing voice as an extension of speech.
I wonder why each little bird has a someone.
And he said, I want you to drop all of the colors and the things that you feel about Briar Rose to your vocal palette, and I want you to paint with your voice.
I'm awfully sorry. I didn't mean to frighten you.
Oh, it wasn't that. It's just that you're
a stranger?
And Prince Philip with Bill Shirley is just as well a really good, solid voice.
And now to make a lovely dress fit to grace a fair princess.
You've just heard Verna Felton, a Disney voice veteran cast in Sleeping Beauty as Flora, the bossy good fairy. She previously voiced one of the haughty circus elephants in Dumbo, the fairy godmother in Cinderella, the Queen of Hearts in Alice in Wonderland, and later Winifred the Elephant in The Jungle Book. She was also well known as Fred Flintstone's dominating mother-in-law, Pearl Slaghoople.
Maleficent doesn't know anything about love or kindness.
Fauna is played by Barbara Jo Allen, best known for her role as Vera Vey on The Bob Hope Show.
I'd like to turn her into a fat old hop toad.
Meriwether was played by Barbara Luddy, who also portrayed Lady in Lady and the Tramp. The incomparable Eleanor Audley, who also voiced the evil stepmother in Cinderella and much later Madame Leota in The Haunted Mansion, was cast not only as the voice, but live action model for Maleficent.
Well, in that event, I'd best be on my way.
Stand back, you fools!
Before animation production began, every shot in the film was performed in live action, with actors in costume serving as models for the animators. The role of Prince Philip was modeled by Ed Kemmer, who played Commander Buzz Corey on television's Space Patrol 5 years before Sleeping Beauty was released. For the final battle sequence, Kemmer was photographed on a wooden buck. Among the actresses who performed in reference footage for the picture were Spring Boynton, Frances Bavier, and Helene Stanley. Helene Stanley was the live-action reference for Princess Aurora. The only known surviving footage of her as Aurora is a clip from the television program Disneyland, which consists of the artists sketching her dancing with the woodland animals. Animator Ollie Johnston and animation historian John Culhane.
I was on the stage while we were shooting the live action, get my input into it and how I wanted to see them do something. I wanted it as broad as it could be and give me the most inspiration.
I've seen some of them. It's very close. For example, the live action reference of the battle between the prince and the dragon, they have steps for him to climb up while he's swinging his sword, so that you can really recreate that. Mark used to say, why make that stuff up when you can see it?
All the live actors' performances were screened for the animator's reference, as Walt Disney insisted that much of Sleeping Beauty's character animation be as close to live action as possible.
Our inspiration for Sleeping Beauty was this wonderful score written more than 75 years ago by Peter Tchaikovsky for his ballet version of the fairy tale.
While Sammy Fain had already composed a more traditional Disney-esque song-based score, the stately sophistication of Ivan Earle's design begged for a more classical approach. While one Sammy Fain song, Once Upon a Dream, does remain in the film and is integral to the story, ultimately, it was decided the score was to be based on the 1890 Sleeping Beauty ballet by Tchaikovsky. George Bruns adapted the original, and it became the first animated film presented in six-channel stereo sound. Mary Costa, story artist Floyd Norman, and Charles Solomon.
George Bruns did a remarkable adaptation of the music for the film.
George was an in-house composer, a great guy who could do anything. It's a very pretty score, that George Bruns could then take and experiment with, recut, riff on the melodies the way the artists were playing off Gothic art.
Disney's distribution arm, Buena Vista Distribution, originally released Sleeping Beauty to theaters in both standard 35mm prints and large format Super Technorama 70 prints equipped with the 6-track stereophonic sound. Some CinemaScope compatible 35mm Technorama prints were released in 4-track stereo. With a production cost of $6 million, it was the most expensive Disney film to that point, and over twice as expensive as each of the preceding 3 Disney animated features. Brian Sibley.
We've forgotten just how successful this film was. It was the second most successful film at the box office after Ben-Hur. If it didn't produce the revenue that was hoped for, that's a different question. It merely means that it cost so much money to make that it didn't recoup its costs. But in the history, the long history of animation, this film stands as something quite unique, something which nobody else has ever attempted before or since. This is a film that says animation is art.
On the initial run, Sleeping Beauty was paired with the short musical documentary film Grand Canyon, which won an Academy Award. During its original release in 1959, Sleeping Beauty earned approximately $7.7 million in box office rentals. When adjusted for ticket price inflation, the domestic gross comes out to $478.22 million, placing it in the top 30 of films adjusted for inflation. Upon its initial release, the film was met with mixed reviews from the critics, often citing the film as being paced too slowly and without enough character development. Today, thanks to its extraordinary stylized designs, lush music score, and large format, widescreen, and stereophonic sound presentation, Sleeping Beauty is hailed as one of the best animated features ever made, attaining a level of perfection in traditional animation not seen before or since. Walt Disney Imagineer, Tony Baxter.
Sleeping Beauty, it's like going to the symphony. You don't have to get so heavily involved in this story. It's more the same thing as enjoying great art. People buy art, they put it in their home, they love looking at it every day. I find this movie very much like that. The Sleeping Beauty Castle actually was known and seen by people a full year before Disneyland actually opened, because Walt Disney had a television show called Disneyland. And every week that show opened with a beautiful shot of Sleeping Beauty Castle.
The first time that I saw the castle, it was a magical experience.
Where would you like to go of all the places in Disneyland?
To the great big castle where Sleeping Beauty is.
You read the stories as a little girl, but actually seeing it, it was really amazing.
This is really the theme symbol of the whole Disneyland and the thing nearest and dearest to Walt Disney's heart.
Walt Disney was intimately involved with the original creators of the castle. You can see on opening day how proud he was.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome.
When the drawbridge came down on July 17th, 1955,
open the Fantasyland Castle!
It became the gateway to the most precious area in all of Disneyland, where our fables and fairy tales unfold. But what was up inside the castle would not be shown to the public for a good 2 years after the opening of Disneyland.
Initially, the castle did have the shops downstairs, but there was no internal elements put into the castle. After the park established itself for a couple of years, Walt came back and said, let's put something on the inside of the castle.
Walt Disney asked Ivan Earle to come down and help design the key show for the Sleeping Beauty Castle.
Ivan Earle was the color stylist for Sleeping Beauty.
his painting style is really quite unique. He uses a lot of like very flat graphic areas, and then he just kind of builds on them layers upon layers, which create a lot of depth in his illustrations.
The Sleeping Beauty Castle project was a series of dioramas in which you look through a glass window and see a story of some kind.
It's kind of a dimensional pop-up storybook. Ken Anderson was the art director for the walkthrough, and it was his responsibility to interpret the concept art that Ivan Earle had done, faithfully reproduce it in Ivan Earle's style for all the scenes and the tableaus in the castle.
Ken had some wonderful ideas for a walkthrough, but we didn't realize how cramped the area was inside of the castle.
They had to use extreme forced perspective to make these things feel much bigger than they were. It meant that they were bending depths by using mirrors to trick your eye into thinking that you were looking to a great distance. They were relying on a lot of our Imagineering illusioneers, some of the pioneers like Yale Gracie, Fred Jurger, Wathel Rogers, and Bob Gurr.
They were all like a combination of artists and scientists.
That was the first application in Disneyland of some artistically brilliant and technically stunning special effects. Nearly 2 years after the opening of Disneyland, on April 29th, 1957, Walt Disney invited Shirley Temple down to open the doors to the inside of that magic castle.
Shirley Temple cut the ribbon, and it was her son's birthday, and so that made it extra special for her.
When the castle opened, the response was incredible because Walt had put in some amazing things that were what we'd call today interactive experiences, where the guests were asked to add their echo to the bottomless pit.
Hello!
Or snore in the sleeping sequence. But to create an experience where we're inviting you to interact with it, inviting you to spend as much time and to flow at your leisure through it, he was inviting all kinds of calamities and unexpected things that we'd learn through doing this experience.
When Walt originally envisioned the castle, he had a route that he set up, and they set the plan up. There was a portion where, on the second floor, you actually went outside the castle.
You were kind of looking out over the turrets and parapets of the castle at different knights and things who had fallen asleep.
Walt walked it and said, "This isn't going to work."
Drawings for another version of that space show up as architectural drawings a month after the opening. And what they ended up putting in that space are scary-looking medieval doors. And the gag was that you would walk up to the keyhole, put your eye in, and you would see some goons from Maleficent's castle in blacklight looking back at you.
The eyes were mirrors, and the mirrors were shaped in different fashions so that it would reflect your eye. And if you blinked, it blinked. And it looked real, and like goons were back there.
In another keyhole, there was a barrel with probably, you know, 50 little mirrors in them that would reflect 50 little eyes back at you.
The mirrored eyes, each one had to be measured very precisely.
So you'd be actually looking at your own eye floating in space where the goon's eye should be. So people would really stop and take their time to look into these keyholes. And all of a sudden, the line started backing up through the room, down the stairway, down into the next area. And everyone's saying, "I wonder what's going on up there. Why aren't we moving?" They ended up shutting down that space, just putting basically a velvet rope across it and closing it down. Another fun thing was at the very end of the ride, and this only lasted about a month. After the happy ending, and we see Prince Philip awakening Sleeping Beauty, at the end, as you went around the very last corner, Maleficent's ominous shadow pops out. Unfortunately, if the goons slowed traffic, this gag stopped traffic completely. Children just backed up, just screaming in terror, sure that there was something around the corner waiting to get them. The walkthrough was designed about 4 years before the film would be complete. So over time, as more and more people saw the film, they began to question, you know, well, gosh, there's a whole lot of things that are in the castle that aren't in the movie. So 21 years later, it was decided to do something that follows more faithfully the story of the motion picture.
In 1977, they completely redesigned the Sleeping Beauty Castle walkthrough. They kept the hallways the same and the shapes of the rooms the same, but they tore out the old sets and they put in new, more three-dimensional scenes. Instead of a Masonite hand-painted cutout done in a very graphic style, you had a three-dimensional sculpted figure with real hair and real clothing, done in miniature, of course.
In 2001, we took a long, hard look at it and we said, gee, you know, this doesn't live up to what people remember in the movie. We probably maybe want to let it go to sleep, like Sleeping Beauty did for a few years. Maybe, hopefully, to awaken with a brand new thing that fits into a world that's very, very different.
And they shut down the walkthrough at that point.
When the opportunity to do the Sleeping Beauty Blu-ray and DVD came around, we were asked by Home Entertainment
to recreate the Sleeping Beauty Castle walkthrough as it was.
So a bunch of us, Home Video and Imagineers, got the key to the castle, which had been locked for about 5 years, and we unlocked the door and walked through something that hadn't been seen for many years. When the castle show was changed, a few of the things were locked in walls that had been boarded over. And in there were the very little goons that you had once peeked your eye through the keyhole, and the mirrors and everything were still intact. They had not seen light for almost 50 years. We were lucky enough to have complete sets of all the working drawings that were done between Ivan's original concepts and Ken Anderson's excellent art direction and drafting design. And we were even so lucky as to find where the special effects were laid out into the scenes.
Some of these scenes have 50 flats in them, all interlocking or going off at different strange angles and with the forced perspective and the strange shape of the different rooms. It may look very strange from the top or the side, but when you get down in and you look at it from that guest view, it makes this amazing little scene that you can see. All of us working on this recreation of the attraction feel very lucky to have been part of it. Because to recreate this in the style of the original Imagineers is almost akin to working with them yourself.
The Sleeping Beauty Castle is an icon. It's a gem. You walk through there and it's so beautiful. It's so special. Looking through all those windows, it's like looking into a jewelry box.
Now that this is done and we've seen the incredible result of it, something you thought you'd never see again is now preserved forever.
Thank you. Chucking my wood!